Suppose you've got two interviewers. They observe the exact same candidate performance, but disagree on whether to hire that candidate. How do you know who's right? Hey y'all, I'm Lucen Mendel. I'm gonna tell you how to write amazing interview rubrics. But first, let's look at what can go wrong. Suppose you have a coding interview where the candidate discusses the problem and implements a partial solution. One interviewer sees this performance and says the candidate gave a great analysis of different approaches and implemented 90% of a working solution, let's hire them. A second interviewer sees the same performance and says, whoa, the candidate wasted time overanalyzing the question, they only completed 2/3 of the important parts of the algorithm, and they didn't write any tests, which is the most important part. No hire. Which interviewer got it right? I don't know. What I do know is that two interviewers saw the same candidate performance, but came to two different conclusions. This is the problem that structured rubrics solve. If testing is on the rubric, every interviewer knows to spend time on testing. If it's not on the rubric, then everyone knows it's noise. Don't use that to make a decision. So how do you create a reliable rubric? You follow these three steps. First, identify which competencies are most relevant to the interviewer's decision. In a senior level behavioral interview, an important competency might be degree of expertise. In a programming interview, it might be technical communication or implementation quality. Step two, for each competency, list the candidate behavior and results that can be observed. In this example, a 5-star scale for assessing implementation quality is turned into a list of radio buttons with specific criteria. If the candidate gets confused about their own code, then the interviewer can see that the code is confusing and select the third radio button. On the other hand, if the code doesn't confuse its author, but also there are no specific code organizing techniques used, then the interviewer can confidently select the second radio button. The interviewer also knows that they're not assessing code quality based on their own opinion of good style, nor whether the candidate follows a particular style guide. Maybe the hiring manager already decided that candidates can learn style requirements on the job, or maybe there is a different interview module that assesses competencies like attention to detail and alignment to team practices. Lastly, rubrics often contain multiple competencies. The third step is to provide interviewers with explicit guidance on how to summarize a completed rubric into a consistent yes or no decision. There are different algorithms you can use depending on your specific situation. For example, each competency could be weighted, so interviewers know how much that competency impacts or doesn't impact their yes-no decision. Or candidates could have to pass a certain bar on each competency or avoid minimum red flags. You could also attach points to each behavior and score the rubric like a test. Or maybe you have multiple templates for job success so that you can hire candidates with different strengths. You decide what works for you. The important takeaway is that differentiating signal from noise is not a fun guessing game. Interviewers make better hiring decisions when they have structured rubrics with checkboxes and radio buttons that describe the candidate behavior they're likely to see. This gets everyone in the hiring process on the same page. Plus, checking boxes on an interview rubric is a lot faster than writing detailed notes, so interviewers can focus on having a great conversation with candidates during the interview, and then afterwards they can quickly get back to the engineering work they, like their candidates, are hired to do.